Before we get into it, let's talk about Ridge Wallet. I've told y'all to get rid of that suitcase already and check out the slim and slick Ridge Wallet. Military grade aluminum, carbon fiber, titanium. Apart from holding your essentials, this wallet might mess around and save your life one day. Everybody loves the Ridge Wallet. 30,000 five-star reviews and it's counting every day. And not just for wallets. Wallets, phone cases, backpacks, perfect for a student like me. Now, the backpack is in the dorm, but check out my beautiful matte white here. I love the design of it. It feels nice. And it's still clean and unscratched after months. Also, if you got an RFID chip in your car, stick that bad boy right in your Ridge Wallet and nobody is hacking that. Ridge keeps your car safe. Free worldwide shipping, free returns in case you don't like it, lifetime guarantee if you do. I mean, what more could you ask for? If you go to ridge.com/spooky and check out anything from the site using the discount code SPOOKY, it'll get you 10% off. Browse all the cool products that Ridge Wallet has, and if you like some, you get 10% off your order if you use SPOOKY at checkout. Let's give a nice applause to Ridge Wallet for sponsoring today's video.
But anywho,
All Night Long 3 is the next addition to the All Night Long franchise, which I would say is maybe underrated. Movies like these are some of my favorites to watch though, because they just have a cool energy surrounding them. And no matter what these films might be preaching, I just don't care enough to believe. This film is preaching that human beings are all trash, not even just the men this time. All Night Long 3 is very similar to the other two films. Weirdo loner goes crazy and kills pretty girls. So if you want to see what happens, including all the messed up parts, stay tuned for the breakdown. Cue to Gohan. Hey, look y'all, it's Mother's Day, the 2010 remake, Trash. Today on Trash World is a dead animal attracting flies for the neighborhood weirdo named Kiku. Kiku is just like the past characters, loner, socially awkward, kinda dumb. Has a liking towards certain kinds of plants. I don't know why he lives next to some airbase though. One day, he sees some girls bullying one of their peers. When I see scenes like this, I imagine these bullies trying any of this shit on 99% of the girls in my old high school. Even middle school girls would just knock the dookie out of these lame ass bullies, have them going home crying. What are y'all being so reserved for over there? Yes, they made her piss on the ground, okay? Honestly, this scene is kind of pointless, you'll see why later. Kiku is risking expulsion and he doesn't give two flucks, wasting his time reading hentai and looking at titty measurements. At night, he works at a sex hotel, one where people can fuck and the workers will clean up when the room is empty. He's used to picking up a lot of used condoms, hair, etc. This lady watches to see when the room is empty, but she kinda gets off on watching. After work, Kiku notices some nudie mags in the trash. It's the start of his trash hunting hobby. The next day after work, his colleague named Birthmark tells him to follow him to see something interesting. Interesting is Sayaka, the girl we saw getting bullied. Now Birthmark calls her a natural masochist, seeing that she's just in his lair and even gives him head willingly. I guess he's sorta right. They love showing her little scars too. Later, Kiku digs around in the trash again. He's starting to piece together that much of it belongs to some girl. He collects her pantyhose, toothbrushes, maxi pads, and an ID all pointing to some girl named Hiromi. Yep, the same girl who's been in all three movies, who also voiced Ino in Naruto. The original Japanese version, of course. He stalks her from afar. Meanwhile, at that sex hotel, a handsome rank-and-file member of the Majima family always brings in a girl to have sex with. Remember this lady? Watching the sex as always. Well, this time she goes to find Kiku, tells him of the secret view that she has, and gives him a hand job. I think she gets off on taunting him a little bit. The very next day, those bullies are back bullying that Sayaka girl. She limps away only to trip on Kiku, but she calls him disgusting and he pushes her down and kicks her injured leg. She seems to be crying and laughing, honestly, and that's the last time we see her. That's why I said it's kind of pointless, but I'm guessing they took some scenes out. Later at night, Kiku is surprised by a person called the Dust Hunter. He knows exactly what Kiku is doing, looking through the trash, and invites him back to his scary-looking lair. Look at all the trash he keeps, all the dirty mementos that he sees as much more worthwhile than people. He knows more about people than they know about themselves, and Kiku is taking notes. Next morning, he prints out a big-ass picture of Hiromi, the girl he is stalking. He's got a wall full of her trash and data in his computer about her. Meanwhile, two of those bullies are running a scam. Basically, compensated dating, except they subdue the client and take his money. On the way out, though, one of the girls drops their name tag, and the sick workers at the hotel use it to find out all about her. The workers, other than Kiku, chase after her in a trash dump and threaten her before knocking her out. Kiku is hidden watching, and they justify raping her because she stole money. Then the mentally challenged one pees on her, but as soon as she wakes up, he literally beats her over the head viciously with a rock. See, I'm surprised she actually survived this, but the three workers leave her there to die, and Kiku gets a fresh idea. He drags her all the way back to his room, unseen. See, that's another thing about a lot of these movies. Usually there's like nobody around, almost like a barren wasteland with a few survivors to do whatever they want. He measures her chest, enters all information to his computer, like all the information, clitoris length, vaginal pressure, etc. He feeds her larvae from flies, but then notices some menstrual bleeding. I didn't pick these two movies because they were both about menstrual bleeding. He goes to the store to get some pads, and it's the same store where Hiromi works at too. When she tells him that he is trash, he suffocates her to death, and once she is dead, he starts dismembering her, but I don't think fingers are so jiggly. He stuffs her inside a suitcase, like the kind you carry in your back pocket because you haven't checked out a rich wallet yet. He digs a spot to bury her, but the Dust Hunter tells him he can just use his furnace. See, he's a killer too, and he thinks people are born incomplete corpses, trash, the moment they are born. As he talks, Kiku hits him with a shovel. He just goes in on him, applying his logic and giving him a taste of his own medicine. After taking over the Dust Hunter lair, he finds a gun that was still loaded and plenty of bullets to use. The next day is Hiromi's birthday. Deranged, he walks in the store with a plant gift, but she's not there. Well, yeah, she took off on her birthday. But tonight on her birthday, she's about to get it in with that same guy who always has one-night stands. I don't know where Kiku's mind is at regarding that. I mean, I guess he's jealous, sure, but I low-key think he wanna just nut in his pants or something. He goes crazy seeing the deed done and beats the lady that helped him nut before running out. He angrily trashes his pervy research that he had for her. He sits there thinking his next move, but knowing him, it's probably gonna take a turn for the worst. Here is the bully girls again, plotting to rob someone else until Kiku surprises them. They just look at him like, "Circus in town? Looks like the freak wants to play." Y'all won't ever get that. He pulls out a gun and shoots her directly in the head. He asks them where Hiromi is, and they tell him that Birthmark came and picked her up. Birthmark is the guy that worked with Kiku. Franklin the Turtle sees some tape and ties him up by the wrists. He makes him play rock, paper, scissors, and whoever wins gets to die. Yeah, okay, look, she's peeing on herself before she dies, okay? Don't leave me alone. Don't ask me about that again. I'm sorry. Sometimes I just want y'all to notice something, but I don't want to say it bluntly, so I act like y'all wanted me to mention it. Meanwhile, the three hotel workers have Hiromi tied up and are beating her hookup for not sharing her. Mentally challenged here gets a hard-on from it, and he rapes the dude. I wasn't expecting that, and then suddenly, this rapist is shot in the head, but you can clearly see the makeup before the bullet left the chamber. I guess he just really wanted this point of view. The other one, shot in the crotch, he's not important, whatever. And then Kiku, the shooter, walks out repeating Hiromi's name. His bullets has ran out, and he is in a tussle with Birthmark until he gains the upper hand with some prod thingy. he shoves the object into his cheeks. With him dead, he goes towards Hiromi, repeating her entire biography back to her. All the data he had in his computer, her birthday, graduation date, menstrual cycle. She insults him, saying he's worse than trash. He counters, saying that if people won't treat me like a human being, then I won't treat them like one. Well, last time I checked, a proper human being doesn't bully, kidnap, and kill, and collect bloody pads, so maybe you should start acting like one first. Next, we see the dead workers all in a trash dump. The movie ends as Kiku sprays his plants, and in the corner is a ghostly Hiromi creeping out of her trash bag. The end. Yeah, I liked All Night Long 2 the best for sure, but this was an easy watch, really. They probably took out a lot of scenes, but it's straight, I guess. Anyway, let's talk about the most disturbed moment and most enjoyed moment, and that's spooky stuff. Cue to Gohan. Alright, so the director of this movie also directed the second film adaptation of Junko Furuta's murder. Concrete was one of them. But before that, there was Concrete Encased High School Girl. Looks like we gotta do that film, and then there's another documentary of her case, if I can get a copy, and then there's the Uzuko Waita manga. Then, these All Night Long films all have instances where high school or just young women in general are tortured similar to Junko Furuta. The most disturbing moment is probably the trash habits of Kiku. I mean, those things are in the trash for a reason, and it would make me throw up if someone pieced together my life based on what I want to forget. Most enjoyed moment is probably the whole trash theme in general. I enjoyed how they all tried tying all that together, especially the humans are trash part. Of course, only some human are trash. Japan, we're here. Remember Red Room, Red Room 2, Girl Hell? Where they were directed by Daisuke Yamanouchi, who was working really hard around 1999 and 2000. He also directed Muzan A, a fake documentary of some random crew trying to figure out what happened to a missing adult video actress. I'm sure Daisuke was inspired by Guinea Pig and Tumbling Doll of Flesh here. Title of the film, Muzan A, refers to a subset of ukiyo-e, woodblock prints and paintings, stuff like that. A precursor to Guro and Arrow Guro images that you've seen in the first disturbing comics. Well, the film doesn't relate that much at all to it, honestly, so maybe its second title, Celluloid Nightmares, is more fitting. Okay, so y'all ready? Cue to Gohan. Daisuke must really love that funky music. Now, the movie is in a documentary format. We've got a host named Kazuyo who thanks us for watching Muzan A, an original documentary. The goal is to report the hidden truths of today's society. That's Daisuke's goal, at least. Also interesting is that the first episode is about a missing AV actress, and then there is no episode 2 or episode 3 after this. So let's go to the adult video place. See, the thing about AV actresses is that they don't do it very long. 3 months tops is the usual lifespan. One actress though named Mai Tsurumi was not your typical porn star. She did it for over a year, and her latest tape was Menstrual Love 4, The Bleeding. Apparently, she was the hottest porn star in Japan, and was even on late night TV shows until she disappeared. Kidnapped, of course. Kozo Okuda, the ultimate porn writer, is an expert who has been investigating Mai's disappearance. He don't say shit except mention the parcel incident. Project P is the company that produced Mai's porn videos, but shortly after she disappeared, they received a little envelope in the mail. It had a snuff tape of Mai's death, apparently. They even defined snuff for ya. Whoever killed Mai is someone who took these videos too seriously. Anyway, Mai is over here sending out these pads and shit like the Rad Brad sends out free copies of games. Now, that snuff film, they keep talking about it, but they ain't showing anything. The police got a copy, but apparently they can't tell if it's real or not. I call bullshit on that. Some things you can just realize are real once you look long enough. Apparently, the production team wants us to see excessive bleeding. It's a menstrual rape scene at that. I mean, this scene is way longer than it should be. Like, what are y'all even waiting for? Go solve the crime. So now they are saying the snuff tape is a rumor. This is all starting to sound like some kind of ploy at this point. These interviews are pretty corny too. Damn, she got them Red Dead Online teeth. So someone secret has gave them the tape. They arrange a meeting to get a copy of the tape, and after maybe about 5 minutes of mundane waiting, the guy finally shows up and here's a copy. What will this alleged snuff film contain? Okay, it's lower quality, I think that's pretty creepy. And then there's a 5-page from hell letter left by the killer describing the murder in detail. Someone pretended to be a part of Project P and lured Maya away. She fell asleep in the car, fast asleep. Once she wakes up, they struggle and he knocks her out and puts her in the trunk. Seems kind of pointless when he could have probably just left her asleep. I think they just wanted us to see how real the kidnapping looks. Editing blurs is a bitch for me. I hate it. It's probably a bitch to edit this blur too. Like, why is she blurred, by the way? This video would be more disturbing if we heard the video instead of just listening to Kazuyo read the letter. Warning. I might start using this warning. It's kind of cool in a scary way. I guess we're about to see a bucket of fuck. Alright, so all we see is Mai getting cut with a machete and having her guts pulled out. If those really are guts, I guess. Soon as it's over, Kazuyo gets up to throw up. Who told you to watch it anyway? They analyze the footage after to determine where the murder took place. Wonder why the police didn't do all that. Now, the producers eventually found out where, and they head to the location of where Mai was put in the trunk. Just a little walking later, they reach a suspicious shed. They should have been more careful though. I'm sure you expected this to happen. See, this killer ran up so nasty that it kinda creeped me out. He grabs Kazuyo and both the cameramen are bludgeoned to death. It's very textbook at this point. They bite Kazuyo's nipple off and stick something weird in her mouth, but she just spits it right out, like boldly, before saying, "Hey, director, cut. This wasn't part of the deal." It turns out that this entire story here was faked. Kazuyo here is Mai all along. They were filming a torture scene, and here are the auditions for this ugly ass movie. Mai wanted to be an actress, and this is her first role. She's kinda mean though, and undermines the director before getting fired on set. The director needs anger management classes, and he eventually kills Mai because she kept calling him a terrible director. The end. So you're probably confused. Well, let me explain. Mai Tsurumi is an AV actress who wants to become a regular actress. She auditions for a documentary in which the story is that Mai goes missing and is cast as Kazuyo, the spokesperson. All instances showing Mai were blurred, so we didn't notice they were the same person, even though anybody could have figured that out. They had the same body type. And then the fake documentary closes in on Kazuyo's character being kidnapped, only for Mai to stop the filming, piss off the director, and get murdered by him for real. So how do y'all feel about this movie? Yeah, it was okay. Now let's get to the most disturbed moment and most enjoyed moment, and that's spooky stuff. Cue the Gohan. I would say the most disturbed moment is the menstrual porn, honestly. It was just pretty gross and yeah. The most enjoyed moment was probably just how fake it was. Like, it was filmed to be a documentary style. I like that a lot, but I can't say I know of many documentaries like this in real life. And that's it. You can find this film on F'd Up Films, but beware, it's not the safest site for your browser, but y'all should know about internet safety by now. Again, thanks for Rich Wallet for sponsoring today's video. Check them out if you are interested. Thanks for watching. Spooky out.